Right now, I'm delighted to ask our chair of our advisory council, James Tanton, to come up and introduce our speaker tonight, Stephen Wolfram.
Thank you. And good evening. It is my absolute pleasure and delight to introduce tonight's speaker for Math Encounters, Dr. Stephen Wolfram. We're in for a real treat, and we're here at wonderful MoMath to do fabulous celebratory math. Stephen is the creator of Mathematica, of Wolfram Alpha, and of the Wolfram language, which each, in turn, have instigated historic paradigm shifts in the fields of computation, artificial intelligence, and complexity theory. Moreover, each have, and quite simply and profoundly, brought the power of accessible deep knowledge to the world. Stephen's commitment to education and personal intellectual growth for all, at all levels, is actually profoundly moving to me. Stephen was born in London and was educated at Eton and Oxford in the UK, to then receive his PhD in theoretical physics at Caltech. He's always had a deep interest in scientific computing. Stephen is MacArthur Fellow and is the author of the groundbreaking text, A New Kind of Science. And he is a devoted father to his four children. I first got to know Stephen when a young lass by the name of Catherine signed up for one of my extracurricular math research courses up in Boston. Each week, Catherine sat up in front of the room drawing edge identification patterns for polygons, while her chauffeur, Stephen, sat back at the room, observed what was going on, and enjoyed the mathematical fun Catherine was clearly experiencing. And I just have to add, just a few months back, I was touched to receive an email from Catherine sharing with me her undergraduate research paper continuing that work from those years before. Mathematics is indeed about play and discovery and pushing new ideas into new realms. And we're in for that sort of treat tonight. So without further ado, I present Dr. Stephen Wolfram for a hands-on adventure in experimental mathematics.
Thanks very much. Well, this is a completely unscripted adventure. So because of the way this is set up, I'm getting to do the second talk. And often I think the second talk is necessarily better than the first one because everybody's practiced. But since I'm doing something that's completely unscripted, it's a high-risk thing because the first one of these, we discovered something really quite interesting. So now I'm going to look at a completely different topic. If this topic horribly fails, I'll show you what we discovered in the previous version here. I was excited at what we managed to figure out. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to do some experimental mathematics. I'm going to use Wolfram language as a tool to explore a particular mathematical question that I thought about 15 minutes ago. Well, let me get started anyway. We don't actually need... I can work around this, perhaps even completely. So what I wanted to... what I want to do is do some mathematical experiments using Wolfram language. And let me just, to get started, some of the really coolest things require me to be able to access the network, but I can do some other things. Let's start off with something that isn't terribly cool at all. Let's make sure that we can actually get another thing to work. Okay, there we go. So maybe we can work out, instead of that, let's work out 1,000 digits of pi, for example. Maybe we can just take, let's do this. Let's find the digits of pi in base 10. Let's find 1,000 of those digits. And then let's take those digits, and for example, let's say we want to take those digits. Let's say we want to work out. Let's make a plot. Let's make a histogram that shows. So a histogram will show how many of each kind of digit occur. So this is showing that in the first 1,000 digits of pi, roughly the different digits occur with roughly equal frequency. People have thought that's the case for pi for a couple of hundred years, although nobody's ever been able to prove that it's true for pi eventually that all digits will occur with equal frequency. But we can start to do these kind of experiments in mathematics. We can also do all kinds of computation. We could say, I don't know, let's make a 3D plot or something of some function here. Then we can say, okay, let's make this a plot that we can manipulate. Let's manipulate that with some parameter here, something like this. So now we'll get a little user interface. We can go and wiggle that around, all those kinds of things. So let's try, I just want to kind of give you some sense of what kinds of things we can do in this language. and then we'll start launching into a particular experiment to try. So, for example, we might say, let's make a random graph. Let's say we have a graph with 400 nodes, 800 edges or something. So that will make a big, messy graph that gets laid out there. Maybe let's make a less messy graph. Let's say we make a table of relationships where, let's say, I goes to, let's say, something like this. We'll say, this will say for every variable, value, integer I, will say, map that to this function I squared mod 200. Let's take that. So that defines a kind of a set of mappings. We can say, show that as a network. And that will, now we can do that. And then we'll get the result. Maybe we can just combine a couple of things here. So this is now, we can say, manipulate that, make a parameter n here, put that there, say, manipulate that with n goes from 2 to 200 in steps of 1 or something. And now each time, the kind of the idea is to sort of have everything be as automatic as possible. So every time I'm moving the slider, we're automatically figuring out kind of how to make a nice layout for these graphs that represent this particular relation here. Well, we can go ahead and do all sorts of other kinds of computation. Let's say we pick up a let's pick up an image here. There we go. There's an image. Okay. Now we can go ahead and manipulate that image. So, for example, let's say we let's do something weird here. Let's make let's partition this image. Let's take that image and partition it into little blocks of size 10. Okay. So there's me kind of broken into little pieces. Let's say I can take, let's take each one of those rows and let's sort that into order by some sorting criterion that's probably based on color. Let's say we image assemble. Let's assemble those images together. And let's get this. Okay, there we have this really messy version of me. And we could just for fun, we could just make the whole thing dynamic. We could say, put in a current image there, put the current image in there, and make this whole thing dynamic. And then we can go and, okay, now we have, oops, I probably should scroll this up. We have, we have some really mixed up, bizarre version of me there. Let me show something else which actually just occurred to me. Let's take those images, the pieces of this image. One thing we can do, let's start using some sort of fancier technology here. Okay, so here's a bunch of little fragments of me, so to speak. Let's flatten that out. We've got a big list of these random little pieces of image. And let's just try doing something. Let's try making a feature space plot. So this is using kind of modern machine learning ideas. See how long this will take. This, okay, so what this just did is it tried to figure out what are the different kinds of blobs that existed in that image. And it then tried to group those blobs into regions of feature space. And what it was doing here, each one of these dots corresponds to one of those blobs. And it was kind of labeling some fraction of those blobs to show. So these are probably the light-colored blobs. These are the darker blobs. OK, that seems to be an eye there. There's probably some other blobs around there that have eyes in them. This is kind of an example of using kind of modern machine learning techniques on, in this case, this random sample of data. The thing I would also like to show is some things about real-world data. Okay, so now we can start to do things like say, what's the population of New York City? So this is not the kind of thing you usually see in a computer language to know about a thing like New York City. But in our language, one can do things like that. We could say, what's the distance between New York City and, Sydney or something? And we'll get some answer. I hope we'll get an answer. Or we could say something like, let's do this. Let's just do something a little bit mathy. Let's say, capital cities in Europe. Let's see what we can get here. Come on. Okay, so that's going to give us capital cities in Europe. So now let's say make a plot of all those cities on the globe. Okay, there they are. Now, an interesting mathy thing to try to do would be to take those cities and let's get the geopositions of all those cities. So that was on line 3, so I'm now going to just ask for geopositions there. Come on, wake up, there we go. And now let's say find shortest tour. So we can, there's this kind of traveling salesman problem, which is go visit all these cities using the minimum distance going between all of these. So this is giving us an ordering. It's saying there's a 14,000-mile traveling salesman tour. Let's say, let's take the last of those, and let's take that list of cities. Where was it up here? Line 3. And let's order those cities by the thing which turned out to be the traveling salesman tour. Then let's say geolist plot of that, and then say join those points together. And so now that should give us, there we go. So that should now give us a traveling salesman tour of the capital cities in Europe. Well, it's a tour, so it's a cycle. So I told it to just make a cycle going through all the cities. So this is just kind of examples of things we can do. We could take, actually, here's a thing we could try doing. Let's see what happens if I do this. Let's say, well, you know what? I'm going to get distracted if we start doing this. I'll do one more thing here. Let's say countries in Europe, for example, and let's just get a list of countries in Europe. Then I could say something like, let's just get flag images for countries in Europe. This just occurred to me. Okay, so here are a bunch of flag images. So now I could, for example, I could say something like chromaticity plot. So this would take the colors of those flag images. So that's showing me where in color space the colors of those flags are. Now, the thing that just occurred to me is let me take those flags and let me do a feature space plot of line 10. Let's see what happens here. Okay, so there we go. So what this is now doing is it's sort of arranging these flags in feature space, and I guess there are the vertical countries, there are the horizontal countries, and then there are, I guess, the cross countries and so on. It's kind of interesting to see that kind of analysis done there. So, and you know, we can do all kinds of things like that. We could say something like, let's say we take word translations. Let's take mathematics. I wonder what. Let's say we want to say let's look at translations of mathematics into a bunch of different languages. Okay, so there's, I hope, mathematics in various different languages. Actually, one thing I'm curious about now, if I take all those languages and I take, let's just take the first element there. Oops, no, I want to take the first. The languages are ordered here in order of number of native speakers. So let's say line 13. So let's do this. And now let's say, for example, let's just take the first letter in each of these things. So let's do a string take of that, comma 1. I think that will do it. Oh, no, it won't. Let me do this. So this will now give me the first letter in the word for mathematics in all these different languages. Now, for example, I could say something like, let me do a word cloud of the values here. So this will now show me what letter. Oh, look at that. M is definitely the most common first letter for the words for mathematics in all these different languages. Actually, if I want to do it better, I could say, let me go ahead and say 17. Okay, so let's say values percent 17, and then let me transliterate all those things. So a lot of these are transliterate, if I spelled it right. There we go. Okay, so now this will, now most of those can be transliterated. So now let me do the word cloud again and see. I bet M is going to be M is the absolute hands down winner of that competition. Okay, so anyway, the point here is just to see kind of what it looks like when you kind of mix real world data together with sort of mathy kinds of things. But what I really wanted to do was an actual sort of math experiment, and here's the experiment I thought about doing. So let's do our math experiment. Okay, it's just so here's the thing I was thinking about, and it was sort of based on James Tanton's presentation from a little while ago, where he was dealing with digits and numbers and things you can do with digits and numbers. Okay, so here's my thing, and it has to do with doing something crazy with digits and numbers. So we can take a number. Let's take the number 456, and we can say we can take those digits, and we can just say integer digits of that, and we'll get a list of digits there. And now we could say something like reverse those digits, okay? We get a number. Now, here's a crazy thing we could do. We could take the digit reverse number, we can make that an integer again, and then we could say, let's take that integer, and let's like add it to the original number we had. Now, this is a somewhat classic kind of recreational math thing, to take a function to nest doing that. So what we're doing is we're repeatedly taking a number. Let's say we take the number 123, and we're taking that number and adding it to the digit reversal of that number. Okay. So one question is, what happens? So if we let's just do this. Let's go ahead and do this for 100 steps, and then let me. Then I guess what I want to do is I want to take all these digits. Let's do this. Let's say integer digits of each of those. And so this is all working base 10. And then I want to say, let's see what this does. Let me just check it's doing the right thing. Yes. OK, so let me say pad left of that. So what that's going to do is it's going to line things up, I hope. Yeah, there we go. So it's going to line things up with a bunch of initial zeros. And now what I can do is I can say make an array plot. OK, so what this is now doing is it's taking all those. It's starting off, so the colors of the squares are determined by the values of those digits. So the darker the square is, the higher the digit. So this is starting off from the number 123, and 100 times it's iterating this operation of doing finding the reversal of the digits, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Okay? So we can ask questions about what happens in the end when we do this. If we just keep doing this, will the thing eventually die out? Will it always grow? What will happen? I think this particular case of reversing, taking a number and adding it to the digit reversal, that there's been some study of that. So I thought we would do something a little bit different here. Let's do some other operations on these numbers. So for example, one thing we could do is instead of reversing the digits, let's just take the digits. And again, this may not be a good idea, but let's take the digits and let's cycle them around. So let's treat the number. So let me look at a function like rotate left. So rotate left will take, let's say, something like ABCD. And if I say rotate left of that, it will make BCDA. Okay? So let's say we do that on the digits of this number. So let's say we say rotate left of the digits of that number. OK. Oh, that's weird. OK. So this is the result of doing a rotation of the digits of the number. So I want to, because I think it's going to be easier to see what's going on, I want to use not base 10, but base 2. So you can take any number, right? You can take some number, whatever it is, and that's what that number is. You can think of it as the integer digits of that in base 10 are, you know, the tens column, the ones column, tens column, et cetera. In base 2, that's the ones column, the twos columns, the two squareds column, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Okay? So we can do the same thing here. Instead of taking this in base 10, let's take it in base 2 here. And let's go ahead and let's see, the from digits we also need to do in base 2. So let's see what happens if we do this. OK, so what we should get here, did I do something crazy and wrong? Let me just check what happened here. What we should have got is something which only has digits. Did I do something wrong? Let's go ahead and just do it for 10 steps. Oh, those are integers. Right, and I forgot this. Yes, that one there. I forgot that integer digits there needed to be comma 2. OK, there we go. So now we've got something in base 2. OK, so let's go ahead and run this a little bit longer, see what it looks like. I don't know what this is going to do at all. OK, so this is pretty weird. This is what we get by just starting from, we're just rotating digits by one step at everything. So let's just try seeing what happens. If we start off with just a single 1 here, wow, that's pretty weird. So this is just starting with a single digit 1 and taking, let's just look at what we get out from this. So this is saying we start with a single 1 and we're just doing, let's just do it for 10 steps. We're just getting, OK, so this is the sequence that we get by taking a single digit 1 and then, actually, I'm now curious whether this sequence, does anybody recognize anything interesting about this sequence? I have no idea. But there's a function called find sequence function, which we can feed that sequence to. And it will try and tell us whether there's something, whether it recognizes that sequence as being some kind of mathematical construct that's like a Fibonacci sequence or something like this. It's thinking for a long time. That's OK. It didn't manage to find anything. So this is a sort of de novo sequence that isn't a recognizable thing that we've seen before. Well, let's take that sequence. OK, so what we're seeing in the digits of that sequence is something quite strange here. Let's try and look. Let's just look at a few different cases and just see whether we happen to see whether there's anything, whether it's always this kind of very irregular structure that we're getting. Notice that there is, if we look inside here, let's just make this picture bigger, we notice that there is some, you know, there are some definite, if you can see, there are some definite kind of triangles, black and white triangles and so on that are there. It's not completely random. And actually, if we look on the right-hand edge, we can see that there's some regularity there. In fact, if I were to take this number and I were to only look at the last few digits, in fact, let's do that. Let's look at, well, one thing we could do is instead of taking just, well, okay, let me do a couple of things here. So first thing is, let's see whether it always looks like this. Let's see whether for every initial number here, whether we always get this kind of mess. So let's go ahead and make a parameter n here. Let's just do it for 100 steps here. Let's go ahead and make a table for n goes up to, I don't know, let's just say n up to 20 of different things. Okay, so these are, okay, so these are all look pretty similar. There's not, let's try, I'll tell you what, let's try doing something where we, just because I want to see whether we can start off with something where nothing interesting happened, let me just change that. Instead of a rotate left, I don't know whether it'll make a difference, let's try using rotate right. Let's see whether that makes any difference to what we get. Absolutely no difference. Okay, except that actually the right-hand edge, in the case of rotate left, the right-hand edge seems to be quite regular. In the case of rotate right, the right-hand edge doesn't seem to be regular at all. So we could, for example, let's go ahead. Let's try and get to something where we can see some regularity in all of this. So one idea that I have is can we just take something where we take these numbers and we just look at the last few digits. Usually it's difficult to find. I should say that, you know, what we're doing here is we've got a very simple rule for how to make these numbers, and we're sort of immediately getting really complicated stuff coming out. And that's something, when you kind of look at the sort of computational universe of all possible programs, one of the big things that I've spent some part of my life discovering is that in the sort of computational universe of all possible programs, you often don't have to go very far before you start seeing very complicated things happening. I think that's highly relevant to a lot of what we see in the natural world, where nature seems to sort of effortlessly make all sorts of complex behavior, and I think it's sort of the same general kind of thing that we're seeing here. But now I'm really curious what, let's see. What I was thinking of doing was taking these things and instead of looking at this thing for an arbitrary length number, I'm going to try and just take this, and at every step I'm going to take mod, let's say 2 to the 20th or something. So what that's going to do, I hope, if I do this correctly, so what this does now is it takes these things and it says I'm only going to look at the, I'm only going to allow this number to grow to 20 digits. And then I'm going to see what happens. So what will happen here is, if we've done that, then it's guaranteed that after a while, this thing has to repeat. Because it's a definite rule, and after because we've only got 20 digits, there are only 2 to the 20th possible configurations. So it's got to repeat somewhere. So let's see if we can figure out how that repetition stuff works. So what we're going to see is, for each one of these, we're going to see, let's take a look here. Hold on. I am looking, so what we're going to find is for every state, for every possible value, so there are 2 to the 20th possible configurations. There are 2 to the 20th sequences of bits here. And so we could just say, let's do range, let's say 2 to the n, actually it's 0 to 2 to the n minus 1. And I'm putting a parameter n in here, so we could say, you know, with n equals 5 or something, we could say what are the possible configurations. Okay, there are these numbers here. So now what I'm going to do is I'm going to say for each of these numbers, I'm going to say this is mod 2 to the n. I'm going to say I want to take that, and I want to say take this thing map to that. Okay, so what this should be doing here, if I've got this right, is I'm going to take for every possible configuration, I'm going to say what does, let's say with n equals 5, for every possible configuration, what is the mapping of, so this is saying if we start off with all zeros, then applying this transformation we'll just get a thing with all zeros. If we start off with a 1, then rotate right plus the original thing for just a 1 will give us a 2. start off with a 2, we get a 3, et cetera. OK, so we've got this whole sort of network here. Now I can just go ahead and say graph. And now what I'll get is this network that shows me what. So each one of these things here, so let's say vertex labels goes to automatic. OK, so for each value here, for each possible configuration of my kind of length 20 or length 5 thing here, this is showing how it maps onto another thing. So this is showing, this shows that after a while, with this length 5 thing, it will always just go to a fixed point. So let's try looking at that. We can say, so this means that if I tried size 5 here, let's try size 5 here, it's going to say that things will get very boring with size 5, the claim is. Let's see, how are we doing this? Should work. OK, so what this is saying is that for most of these size 5 things, did I do size 5 correctly? Mod 2 to the 5. Did I get this wrong? It's saying, what did I do wrong here? I don't think I did anything wrong. OK, so the point here is that what this is implying is that the thing will always, it will start off from state 1, and eventually it will evolve down here. It will just follow the arrows and eventually evolve to state 47, at which point it will just stay constant. OK, so what this is hopefully going to do, there we go. This shows how boring this gets. This shows that most of the time, this will just evolve. I don't even need to go for 100 steps. I can go for like 30 steps. Most of the time, this will just repeat. Okay, so this is saying if I make the thing. So now this is giving me a map of, let me see what's happening here. This is, I don't want to go from 0 here. I want to go from, I want to do that. I think I want to do, yeah, actually, I can go to 2 to the n. OK, so this is showing. This is showing what happens, that most of the time, for most initial conditions, it just evolves to a fixed state and then stops there. So let's see. We have this here. And what this is doing, OK. So this is the danger of an actual live experiment, is that things don't. OK, so what we've got here, this is the actual sequence of numbers that we're getting out, OK? So what we're seeing here is something which, as you might expect, if I say find transient repeat on that, oops, find transient repeat. Let's see, what do I have to do here? Let's see, at least n times. So let's say find transient repeat 4 times on that. Let's do this. So this is now going to turn this into something. OK, let's run this a little bit longer. Let's run it 300 steps. And let's say find transient repeat on that. So this is going to find us, this says, it has a 1, 2, 3 transient, and then it repeats in this cycle going 6, 9, 21, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So that, I think, is the correct behavior. Now the question is, why were we not seeing that in the previous thing that we were doing? And so what should be happening there is we should be going, I think I should just do it this way. So I should take take each one of those numbers, and I should say map that to this. And then I should say go across range 2 to the 5. Here, and then I get a bunch of mappings there, and now I say graph that. Okay, this is much better. This is what I would expect it to look like. But what this is showing is that with this rule, where we're just rotating one thing, we're getting a cycle here, and the thing is after a while, it's just going into this one cycle. And what this is saying is, from any initial condition, there's just one thing that can end up happening. There's just one cycle that it goes into. Okay. So let's try trying something slightly different here. Let's say, let's do the same thing. Let's go ahead and just say for size n here, let's do that for size n. And let's say we make a table of the graphs for size n with n going from, let's say, 2 to, I don't know, let's say to 10. Okay. So now what this is going to do is it's going to make that corresponding plot. OK, this is kind of interesting. So this is showing that, I think that was the case we were already looking at, this is now making a cycle. So a bunch of different initial conditions are all leading to this one cycle. Here's a case where different initial conditions have different results. And what happens at the end is that the thing just goes to a fixed point. It doesn't cycle anymore. And so here, okay, so there's somewhere there are fixed points, as in it just evolves for a while and then it gets stuck, and others where it goes into a cycle. So what we're seeing is, okay, we're seeing a bunch of different things going on here, a bunch of different cases. So what we're seeing, it's again remarkably complicated. Given how simple the thing that we were doing was, it's remarkable how complicated these pictures end up being, that correspond to asking the question, given starting from, I'm actually really surprised at how messy this already looks. But let's see if we can get a case. Let us try, gosh, what can we try here? We can try, does anybody have an idea? Yes, please.
Is there a pattern that prime numbers tend to cycle with positive numbers?
Let's find out. Let's see. I mean, so let's just, the first very minimal thing we can do is just to label these pictures so we know which one is which. Okay, so four, no, failure at the outset. No, seven is a non-cycling one, so there's nothing exciting about that. We could try looking at, let's look at what these actual fixed points are. So let's actually run. So what we were doing up here, let's see, we want to do this kind of thing. So we want to take each of these numbers, and we want to say, for each of these, let's go ahead and let's try this. Fine, transient repeat. So let's look at what the things end up going to. So let's say comma four here. Let's run it for 1,000 steps just so we get a little bit more data. Let's see, this wants to go to, so what I'm doing here is I'm just starting from the single one. So I'm not starting from all possible initial conditions. I'm just starting from a single one, and I'm asking it to find the, let's go up to n equals 5 here, for example. Okay, so what this is doing is for each of these, let's put them in a column. So we see what's happening here. So for each of these, this is the transient. So this is saying we start with a 1, and then it goes to a 0, and then it keeps cycling with 0. We start from a 1, it goes to 2, 3, it keeps cycling with that. In this case, it just cycles, 1, 2, 3, 6, 1, 2, 3, 6. So what we're doing here, so let's go ahead and do this up to a slightly bigger number. Okay, so what we're seeing is these are, so here we're seeing the cycles. So these cycles, so for example, if we start off with the number 102, for example, and that is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. With 102, the claim is that this will be on, if we start with the number 102, and we do the case of 7 here, hold on one second. Do the case of 7, and we start with, instead of starting with n, we start with 102 here. And now we make that an array plot, get rid of this. Okay, so the claim is that that will cycle, so that cycles with a certain period, okay? All right, let's just see. What's surprising me here, again, is that this is, it kind of follows the thing that I've studied a lot in my life, which is, really simple rule, really complicated behavior. Let's just try what happens if, let's try something utterly trivial. Let's just say instead of adding the number to, let's try something, because I want to get to something where nothing interesting happened, and then we can work back up from that. Okay, so let's try, instead of doing this, let's just try, and maybe the answer to this is completely obvious and somebody can say if it is. Instead of adding it to the original number again, let's just add 1 to the number. So let's do the cycling of the digits. And okay, that was trivial. So we cycled the digits and we added 1 to the original number. Okay, let's just try adding n, where n can go from let's just try n goes up to 20 or something. Let's see whether it's always trivial to do that. Okay. Yes, it's always trivial. So what we're doing here is we're just adding a fixed constant at each step, and then we're doing this rotate left thing. Okay, well, let's try doing, so that turned out to be trivial. Good, that's, now let's try, how about this? How about we say, We multiply that by 2 here. So we say 2 times, oops, we do the from digits of that. We do 2 times that from digits. Let's try that. OK. So there what's happening is for some numbers, that multiplication by 2 is causing it to produce the number 1111111111, and others it's staying fixed. So we can probably figure out for which numbers, let's see. So what we want to do there, if we want to figure out just for which numbers it's going getting big like that, let's just go ahead and say, what do we want to do here? I just want to say last of pad left of that. So this is now going to figure out which numbers. So this is just going to make a table of the, okay. So this is showing for some, in the case of some numbers, we're getting a whole bunch of ones. In the case of other numbers, we're getting nothing much happening. So let's go ahead and figure out for each of these, what's the length of the output? Okay, so there we go. So now for some numbers, for some initial numbers, we're getting a bunch of, we're getting something really long happening. So it appears to be the case that every fourth one of these numbers has something large happening. And for other numbers, so when we add something which is a multiple of, which is equal to 1 mod 4, it looks like. What's that? The 3 mod 3, yes. 1 mod 3, for some reason, this is then giving us a big number. Actually, let's try, okay, so instead of putting a 2 in there, let's try and change this a bit. Let's put a 3 in there instead. And let's see whether that does anything different. So let's say we put a 3 there. Okay. Oh, okay. Now it's getting stripy. Let's see what happened. Let's see what happens. So what we're doing here is we're multiplying that by, let's see what happens if we just, again, change this function a little bit. Instead of adding 1 to that, let's just say 3 times that whole thing. See whether that does anything different. No. Very similar. Okay. Now I'm curious. Okay, so what, oh, that's kind of fun. So what's happening here, let's try just doing this. Let's try doing, okay, still nothing interesting going on. So let's see what happens if we, so the question really is, we're taking a number, we're multiplying, we're rotating its digits a bit, we're multiplying by some fixed number. The question is, will anything interesting ever happen with this kind of structure? So let's go ahead and try and answer that question. I don't know the answer, obviously. Let's say we take that, and I mean the thing that can happen with these things is that you get a tremendous surprise. You know, nothing interesting will happen for a while, and then suddenly something bizarrely different will happen. Okay, so we're changing the thing that we're multiplying by, and again, oh, weird. Okay, so oh my gosh, okay. Okay, I didn't know at all this was going to happen. Okay, so most of these were pretty boring. They were just repetitive type behavior. And suddenly, we have one here that just went wild. Okay? So, wow, okay. All right, let's find out which number that is. The first thing, of course, I forgot to label any of these things, which was silly. So let's go ahead and just put labels around them. Okay, so for some reason, 13 is our unlucky number here, where instead of getting nice regular behavior, we suddenly start to get something weird happening. And 17, 19, the same way. Curiously, they are primes. Let's go up to 50 and just see whether that pattern by any chance continues. Okay, so 13, 17, 19, 21. Sorry, 22, okay. So definitely we're losing on the primes idea. But it's getting more common, apparently, to get something weird happening when we get up to these larger numbers. So let's, wow. Okay, so let's just try looking at this one, 13. Yeah, we could try that. But I want to dig into 13, because I'm sort of wondering what on earth is going on there. Those numbers in binary. Interesting question. All right, well, that would require us to, yes, that's a really good question. Okay, so what we need to do then is we need to automatically analyze. Okay, let me see if I can use something really high tech here. Okay, let me try something that let's live really dangerously here. Let's try doing the following. Let's make those images. Okay, this may be an utter disaster. Okay, these are images, and now actually let me get rid of the labeling for a moment. I just want to see whether something is going to happen that uses some kind of high-tech thing. Okay, so there are a bunch of these images. Now, let's use the very new, let's use this and see what happens here and see what it does. Okay, so what that's doing is, that's kind of fun. So the feature space plot, which is just using, I mean, this is using features which are visual features that are based on distinguishing pictures of elephants and turtles and things. So it's not to be sure that that will be, but what it's doing here is it is separating out. Okay, so it didn't do a great, oh yeah, it did actually. All the ones that have complex behavior are showing up in this side of the feature space plot. And so that's kind of interesting. I don't think this is a perfect way to do it. We would have to train. We could use a fancy neural net and train it to do this, but I think we might have an easier heuristic. Let's see whether we've got an easier heuristic. I think the easier heuristic is going to be, let's just look at these pictures. I think the easier heuristic is just did it repeat? Because all these things here are, well, did the right-hand side, did the right-hand side repeat is not going to do it for us because these ones here have the right-hand side repeating. So we need a heuristic for when we've got complex behavior. Maybe what we need to do, let me think about this for a second. How are we going to get, we could do, okay, there's a really disgusting heuristic we could use, which is to try doing image compression on these things and see which ones are easily compressible. That's really grotesque, but we can try that. Let's try that. So let's say we've got these images here. And so, you know, when you do something like, you take something like this. Okay, this is just super grotesque, but Maybe actually we can just try doing an entropy measure. We might be able to do that. Let's get this down here. Let's say images of this is equal, well, images of that. Okay, now let's say, I think there's a thing, image entropy? No, let's just try saying entropy. Okay, I don't know what this does, so we can, let's just see whether okay, it gives a number. Let's see what happens if we say apply entropy to all those images. Oops. Well, that's kind of weird. So let's just look. Let's just make a histogram of those entropies. Just see whether we see any structure in this. Well, okay, there is some structure. So there are ones that appear to have lower entropy, but I don't know whether this is. But the entropy is kind of a measure of how much randomness there is in the image. And a lot of them seem to have entropies. I'm a little surprised. Okay, the thing I was going to try doing, humph. Let me think about this for a second. Anybody got an idea what to do here? We could. I don't know how useful that will be, but we can certainly, let's take a random image here, and let's take, oops, no, what we want to do there, I think we want to say, I predict this is going to be absolutely useless, okay, now we have to take, yeah, I mean, I predict this is just going to give garbage. Now we just say, so I'm taking, that's hopeless. I think what we want to, let's just see. I'll tell you what, let's just take just a couple of minutes and take a look at the case of 13 and see whether we can just see something interesting might happen there. Yeah.
Can you do a look at four pixel blocks. Can you do, so the stripy
good
ones.
Good point, that's a good point. We'll have some regularity.
Right.
We'll have vertical regularity.
The stripy ones have only straight up and down. They don't have crisscross
exactly.
blocks.
Exactly, let's break, great idea. Okay, so let's take this. So what we're going to do here is instead of turning these into images, let's just get our data again. Okay, so John's idea there was, let me illustrate the idea. So let's try, that was the case, well, let's just take the case of 13 just to have one to experiment on, and let's take size 20 here. Okay, so this is a grid. We can make this as a grid of numbers. Fine, that's what it'll look like. So the idea is take that grid of numbers and break it into 2x2 blocks, okay? So I'm going to break it into, I don't think it doesn't really matter whether they're overlapping or non-overlapping two by two blocks, I believe. I think we just have to break this into 2x2 blocks. Okay, so now what this is going to do is it's going to make us a collection of 2x2 blocks. Okay, so now what I'm going to do is I'm going to, because this is now a block, a two-dimensional grid of 2x2 blocks, I'm going to do one thing here, which is flatten this out. And then what I'm going to do is I'm going to count the number of times each of those 2x2 blocks occurs. Okay, so what this is showing is the 2x2 block 0000 occurs 132 times. So what we're seeing is the number of times each of these types of 2x2 block occur, right? And so what should be the case is in those patterns that have a lot of, you know, complicated stuff going on, we'll see a much broader distribution of types of 2x2 blocks that occur. So let's take this thing. So this is showing, so there are, we've got 2 to the, yeah, we've got 16 possible 2x2 blocks. And so what we're seeing here is for each of those 16 possible 2x2 blocks, we're seeing how what the frequency with which that block occurs is. So what this is saying is, in this particular case, if we just do if we do like a histogram of the values here, it's saying that a bunch of different values. No, that's not what I want to say. I just want to do a bar chart, right, of this, which is just going to say, let's try another case. Let's try a case that was just a pure stripy case. So let's take the case, where do we have one that's nicely labeled? Well, let's take the case of, 5 or something. Let's take the case of 5. Instead of the case of 13, let's do the same analysis for the case of 5. Where was it? 5 there. So what we're finding in this case is we basically only get most of the 2x2 blocks never occur. Okay? So the thing we want to do then is to take, even we could just do a very basic analysis, which is how many 2x2 blocks, how many distinct 2x2 blocks occur, right? And so that we could get that. Actually, we don't even need to do this counts thing. We can just say the union of what is the union gives us the, let's see, where do we go here? I think that's right. Okay, so that's showing us which 2x2 blocks occur. So now we want to know how many distinct 2x2 blocks occur. So that's the number of distinct 2x2 blocks that occur. And let's make that parameter A then again, and let's make a table of A goes up to 20. And let's see how many distinct 2x2 blocks occur. And let's make a list line plot of that. And that will show us that's showing us for each one of those cases how many distinct 2x2 blocks occur. And this is not quite as good as I would have liked, because it's showing that there are some peaks here, but it's not showing that there's a kind of a terrible trough. So I think we would do better here to look at, instead of looking at how many occur, let's actually look at the, let's do this.
I think it might be just do all 16 occur, because the first one that has all 16 occur is the first seed, which is what we want.
Oh, yeah, you're absolutely right. Yes, good idea. Okay, we've got a winning idea there. Okay, so let's just do this. Okay, great. So let's go ahead and just get this, and let's go up to like 50 or something here, and then let's say, so that's going to give us, okay, so now let's say position of 16 in there, position in that of 16. Okay, so actually let me just say, flatten that out. Okay, so here is our sequence of cases where complex behavior occurs. And now let's see, what can we see about that sequence of numbers? We could try doing find sequence function. I am not hopeful. But I'll be amazed if this comes back with something. But an alternative to that is just start looking at, for example, how frequent are those numbers? Let's take a look here. Come on. You see, if it's failing, it's going to think very hard before it gives up. So it takes a little while to decide that it can't do it. But this is giving us kind of, this is sort of interesting because it's kind of giving us the density of complex behavior in the space of systems. It's trying really hard for us. It gave up. So let's just try looking. Okay, yeah, that's nothing simple. That's the sequence of differences. So how far do you have to go between these things to get to an all 16? Let's just try this. I don't know, I'm not thinking about just how much computation is involved in this, but let's try a bigger case of this. Oh, that was really fast. Okay, so given that that was really fast. So after a while, it looks like they're all winners, so to speak. Everything is a 16. So that means that after a while, somehow it's escaping from the zone where it just has simple behavior. And let's see if there are any non-6, oh my gosh, that's so weird. There's a non-16 even out far out in this thing. So let's make a plot. Let's make a list. Oops, not what I wanted to do. Let's just make a plot here of, go down here. Sorry, where are we? Okay, that is totally weird. So what that's saying is, as you go, at the very beginning, you don't get very complicated behavior. But after a while, it starts getting complicated. And then most of the time, it's complicated. But just occasionally, it isn't. Very weird. All right, we should probably wrap up here because I'm going way over time. But I mean, just to, this is experimental mathematics, so to speak. What's interesting is, the main probably takeaway from this is there's a lot of very low-hanging fruit. It's really pretty easy to find things where, you know, I'm sure there's been no analysis ever made of the things that we just looked at. We just discovered a bunch of stuff. And if we spent another few hours, we'd probably have the raw material to write some paper about this cool kind of system. And that's pretty neat. And I think, you know, the thing that I want to sort of emphasize is, you know, this is anybody can do this, so to speak. This is not, I'm reasonably fluent in the tool I just spent 30 years building. But actually, the really scary thing is I've now seen kids. Probably the scariest thing I've seen is a bunch of 11-year-olds who've learnt our language and who can do something that I absolutely can't do, which is they can speak the language. Like it's like nest list of hash of this and that and the other, and they can speak it at more or less standard output speed. And I can't understand it, and that's, you know, I have to type it to be able to get it. But the thing that I've noticed of people learning language, I noticed it with one of my kids actually, there comes this moment when you can kind of think about some problem computationally and start typing before you could explain what you're thinking about, so to speak. Much as when you learn a human language, you get to the point where you can be starting to speak French. I almost got to that point without kind of thinking about the English first and then translating it. And that's kind of an exciting thing because it's a really step up for what us humans, so to speak, can do when we can get to the point where we can kind of be close enough to our computers to sort of think computationally and make use of kind of all of the knowledge that we've now built into these systems.
Let's give a round of applause for Stephen Wolfram.